I would like to thank Walter Schieving, Marcus Dudley, and Connie DeLine for the possibility to present our approaches, or maybe new approaches to new diagnostics called Cine MRI and CSF-PET from my team in Freiburg. First of all, thank you very much to my excellent team in Freiburg, and these are just the people taking special interest in CSF leaks, including, of course, neuroradiology, neurology, and even nuclear medicine. So I had a long interest in finding additional diagnostic ways in CSF leaks, and I did a lot of work at the time when I worked in Bern in Switzerland, and did ultrasound of the optic nerve sheath, and it was a big difference when the patients were lying or were standing, but unfortunately nobody's using it, and even we don't use it anymore because it's so user dependent. And probably we use it from time to time after surgery or after embolization or after patching, whether to discriminate still having low pressure headache or whether there's a high pressure rebound intracranial hypertension. And there was another hobby developed in Bern at that time, the lumbar infusion testing. And I think it's very natural, very obvious if you do a lumbar puncture anyway to challenge the system with fluid. And of course you should have a completely different response of the system when there is a hole. So this, we thought, okay, that's the solution to this disease. And in the beginning, you have clearly different pressure curves and you have clearly different resistance CSF outflow. But unfortunately, only the beginning of the disease. And after 3 months, it levels out. And even there's a reversed response of the CSF system to which we don't really have an answer yet. So do we need, after seeing these beautiful presentations of Marcel and Peter, do we still need other diagnostic stuff? I think we do need. I've never heard anyone presenting the radiation dose that we are doing to our patients with these studies. And they are tremendous. So this is just, we are a referral center in Germany. We get a lot of patients from other centers and from all over Europe. And this is just one example of a dose a patient received at 1 day during diagnostic study for CSF leak. This is kind of radiotherapy. And we try to deliver the dose in with each study we do, and they are really quite significant. So there might be a way to improve our diagnostic workup. Then we got back to radionuclide cystoscopy, which was, I think, a breakthrough study in 50 years ago, published in Nature, showing first time in man the CSF motion. The CSF is running from the ventricles to the subarachnoid space and vice versa, which was very interesting. But nowadays, cystoscopy isn't done by anyone with a reason. It has a very low spatial resolution, low temporal resolution, and it takes very long, several days to perform the study. And this is a slide by my nuclear medicine colleague, Professor Meyer. He says, even nuclear medicine practitioners are reluctant to perform a radionuclide cystoscopy to the Stone Age image quality. But there is a progress, and we can do cystoscopy with PET, positron emission tomography, and there are clear advantages of PET. So we have a way better spatial resolution. Yeah, it's faster. You can scan the whole body in 10 minutes. It's a hybrid imaging system. And I think there's the beauty of it. You can quantify. You can now really quantify what's going on in the CSF system. You have a certain amount of a dose that is in the system, and then you can measure the decline and the washout. This is a clear advantage. So our question was, are there any direct or indirect signs and quantitative signs of the half-time of the CSF washout in patients with spinal CSF leaks? And is CSF PET useful for A, answering the question, is there a CSF leak, and B, where is the leak? Of course, the questions we all have to ask ourselves. It's done in 5 hours. So we inject 40 to 50 millibecquerels of gallium DOTA and do a scan 1 hour, 3 hours, and 5 hours after injection. And very interestingly, we had a very high sensitivity of the lack of trace accumulation over the convexities after 5 hours. So on the upper row, there is normal physiologic accumulation of the tracer over the cerebral hemispheres. And in the presence of a spinal CSF leak, you don't see that accumulation over the cerebral hemispheres. So this is an indirect sign. Another indirect sign is extrathecal tracer accumulation. So in the presence of a CSF leak, now you have a very high specificity. You have next to the thecal sac, you have this tracer accumulation. And it is very important now to recognize this is not a localizing sign. This is a sign for the presence, for the accumulation of the tracer next to the thecal sac, not where it egresses out of the thecal sac. So just to give you some more examples, when you have no leak, there is a clear accumulation over the cerebral hemispheres. When you have an artificial leak here at the injection site, there is still accumulation over the hemispheres. But with a spinal CSF leak, you have no accumulation, and you have this paraspinal, not localizing accumulation of the nuclei. So to summarize, gallium dot positron emission tomography for the diagnosis of spinal CSF leaks, we have a quantitative sign, the T half time. If it is below 7.9, there is a washout, there is an egress through the spinal CSF leak or through the spinal CSF fistula. And you have this indirect signs, not quantitative, whether there is accumulation over the hemispheres or not, or whether they have this paraspinal accumulation. So it's very good for saying, yes, there is a leak. It's not useful for localizing. But still, if you look at the millisieverts, the whole gadolinium CSF PET is only around 5 millisieverts as compared to the over 200 we've seen with repetitive myelograms. And probably if I think at the patients Walter Schiewink has introduced to us with the behavioral variant, frontotemporal dementia, elucidating pathophysiology, and so probably this could be a study used as a gatekeeper to include patients in further and repetitive myelograms and imaging. So this has been done in nuclear medicine department together with our neurosurgical and urological department in Freiburg. And I would like to introduce another additional diagnostic tool, phase contrast MRI. It's very fast. It takes us, the whole sequence takes 2 minutes, and you don't have to use intrathecal or intravenous, no contrast at all. This is how it looks like. And you're looking at the motion of the spinal cord and the backflow and outflow and inflow of the CSF around the level of C2. And there, the question is how much support is there in SIH, where there's a low volume, low pressure, loss of CSF, probably the motion of the spinal cord at this level is increased as compared to the normal state. And in IIH, it might even be decreased, the motion there. And these are the results. So in SIH patients, indeed, there was a higher motion as compared to healthy patients, and even way higher than as compared to IIH patients. And interestingly, the total displacement and also the velocity of the speed of the spinal cord motion was significantly, highly significantly different between patients and controls. And for the proof of concept, we included only so-called SLEC positive patients with epidural fluid. And of course, in these patients, you already know that they have a CSF leak, there is epidural fluid, but still, you could use this very fast non-contrast diagnostic test to elucidate the pathophysiology in these patients. Again, think about FTD patients, for instance, or in patients where you're unsecure. But the next step is now, let's include patients with fistulas. And we did that in the meantime. And now we over doubled our patient number, and we have 47 SIH patients included. Also, half of them now have type 2 and have type 3 lesions. So CSF venous fistulas, and the results are very robust. And even in type 3 lesions, there is a higher speed of spinal cord motion. And probably this is even also related to pathophysiology and all the signs and symptoms in these patients, because there's an abnormal motion of the brainstem and the spinal cord. And so luckily the results are corroborated, and we have a high sensitivity and specificity as compared to healthy controls or healthy participants. This has been done now in 57 patients and 68 healthy controls. So it might very well be useful. Again, 2 minutes, fast scan, no gadolinium. for triggering further diagnostics and also for follow-up purposes, whether a fistula reopens or whether there's a new CSF fistula forming, and probably also for the leftovers, so to say. So in the unknown group, and if you looked more specifically or more closely into this unknown group, there were 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 patients with a high burn score. And probably we just missed finding the leak in these patients. And these are the candidates for redoing myelograms over and over again. And we can also use it for monitoring. This is a case of a CSF venous fistula. And you see before a targeted fibrin glue patch, there was this pattern of motion. We had relapse and there was basically no difference. And after surgery, you know, okay, now the fistula is closed. And again, 2 minute, no gadolinium. You can also use it, and a very interesting data I haven't presented yet. You can use it also in IIH. So there seems to be a spectrum of the spinal cord motion from SIH to normal patients or to normal controls and to IIH patients. And this is a very difficult patient group, IIH patients. And after standing, it truly normalized, but still having headache. And we could clearly show that the stand was open and it was a medication overuse differential in this patient. So it's fast, 2 minutes, no GAD. It's diagnostic also for the CSF venous fistulas and probably for the unknown patients, and probably to elucidate further on the pathophysiology and also for monitoring patients with this disease. Special thanks here to Katharina Wolf, who is a bright neurologist who is doing her neurosurgery residency at the moment, and of course also to Niklas Lutzen and Horst Urbach, and also to Professor Meyer from nuclear medicine. And to give you some more news in diagnostics, so I think Peter has mentioned it already, there is this ultra high resolution cone beam cumulative tomography just published a couple of weeks ago, where you can really clearly depict the CSF in this fistula with a very high image quality. And I've already shown these images in Freiburg at our meeting. This is a piece of art, I think, done by Niklas Lutzen and Horst Urbach, where you can clearly see the fluid level here in the cyst, and then the CSF, the venous fistula, is filling here, very high image resolution. And last, probably, we can also use just simply another location of looking, so looking for the leak. This was also already mentioned by the speakers about imaging. Probably you missed the sacrum or the lower parts of the spinal cord. And with heavily T2 weighted imaging, we were able to find probably it's just another location. Probably it's a fourth type of CSF leak, which we call the sacral dural tears, and which we found and published this year that this probably less than 10% in our cohort, that it is indeed worthwhile including the lower part and the sacrum in high T2 weighted MRI imaging. And you can find and localize these sacral CSF lesions, and usually they respond very well to blood patching. And probably the last slide for new diagnostics is what we are looking for is for a blood test for SIH. And there's just very, very, very preliminary data from my group in Freiburg. This is a prospective proteomic study we did only in, I think, 10 or 20 patients. And there is a clearly distinct pattern of proteomics and metabolomics upregulation in the CSF. So this would be probably a target for further investigation. And so that's it from Freiburg. Thank you very much for your attention.